Okay, I think we are ready to go here. So come on in, everybody. We're going to get started in like 30 seconds. Here we go. I would like my brother.
You might as well go. I mean, you don't have to have surgery. You just have to find out what you're doing. Seriously? No.
Okay, gang, let's do this. Welcome. And we are now into the sixth chapter of Romans, which is cool and exciting. Let's see, housekeeping things. I think we need some more ushers at 7 p.m. Christmas Eve. So that's something to think about. And I think we'll also be, anyway, so that's good. So things are shaping up really well for Christmas Eve. Just remember, no 11 p.m. service. That service has been moved to 9 p.m.
No Christmas Day this year.
And no Christmas Day this year, right. Yep.
Are we doing longest night this year?
And we do not have something scheduled at this point for longest night. So, yep. Okay. With that, let's launch into this. I always love to start with the prayer, the Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Let us pray. Gracious God, we do pray for your Spirit to be with us as we open your word together. We give thanks that you promised us that through the word preached and proclaimed and heard and taught, your Spirit comes and ignites and creates faith and sustains faith. So be with us as we continue to walk and journey through this incredible letter together. And we pray all of this in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. All right, we always do a little bit of review, so this is the first part of Romans that we're reviewing. Remember, it started out after Paul said, where sin increased, grace increased, and so then he has to ask the question, what then shall we sin so that there'll be more mercy, or this type of thing? And so the criticism of Paul clearly rushed in. Well, Paul advocates moral laxity, apathy, you know, more sin. You know, in other words, he's an antinomian, anti-law, anti-standards, this type of thing. So, so Paul had to undergo that criticism. Guess what? Our beloved Martin Luther had the same criticism. Rome rushed in right away and said, if Luther has his way, there'll be debauchery and chaos and nobody's going to do anything, etc. You know, everything will fall apart if you take away the law as the focus of, getting people to be moral. So, Paul doesn't go to the law, as we discovered last week, to answer this issue, but he goes to baptism. He says, we've been joined to Christ's death. We've died. We've been buried with Christ. And so we talked about baptism last week and how important it is, and that we have a high view of baptism in the sense that we believe it is sacramental, that it does something. God communicates something. God gives something. It is not simply something we do to dedicate ourselves to God or to Christ. Now, that's certainly a part of baptism, but that is secondary to God making a covenant with us. And so we are actually joined to Christ. That's the language of the Apostle Paul in Romans 6. And so we die, and so Paul will go and say, well, so since you've died to something, why would we then, you know, celebrate sin and go back into that? And so we then talked about how in Romans 6, now that we've been joined to Christ, that there is now a dual nature in all of us as Christians. And so we looked at this little chart that... we've got the old Adam, the old turned in sinful self, but then in baptism we have a new self, a new life, and that these go together. Where are we? We're in this place where we've got the new life and the old life, or as Paul would sometimes say, and Luther loved to say, we have an old Adam and a new Adam, or new Christ, the Christ in us, or Eve for that matter. So we talked about the things that end with the start of the new life and the things that end with death. And we saw how often baptism is connected to a death. That's what Paul is saying. So something dies in baptism, and the old and the new overlap. And so this was your list that you gave me. These are all things that end with baptism. Sin is separation from God, enslavement to sin, fear of wrath and punishment. It's all up there. This is what we talked about last week, and this is what you came up with, and you're absolutely 100% right on. I love this one, that we now have assurance of our acceptance and forgiveness, whereas before baptism, we didn't have that. It was uncertain. We never know. Now in baptism, we've received a promise. When I was in Ethiopia and, talking to a lot of the Christians there, and I talked to many who used to be in Islam and had become Christian, and when I asked, well, what made the difference for you, it was this, assurance. Because in Islam, and I'm not being pejorative here intentionally or anything, I would say this about pretty much any world religion, truthfully. You never know. I mean, a Muslim, faithful Muslim will work their whole life to do righteousness and follow the law, the Quran, but they would say, we never know until we die, whether we our scale, you know, our good works outweighed our not good works. And so you don't have that assurance. Well, I want to tell you something. Even though Christians so often don't realize this because they think faith means your internal faith and not God's promise, because Christians live their life without this assurance. Oh, I think I might have messed up too bad this time. Well, go back to baptism and die again by confessing your sins. And you have the assurance of forgiveness and grace. Where does Paul say this a little later in Romans? It's the famous Romans 8 passage. Who or what shall separate us from the love of Christ? And he gives a big list, and then he says, no. I'm convinced that none of these things can separate us from the love of God in Christ Jesus. That's what you have in the faith of your baptism. You have assurance. So, but notice, we still have sin. Does not end with baptism. We still have our old nature. We have arthritis, and we have pain and sorrow. When the old Adam and Eve still go on, and there's suffering in this world, and there's death itself is still there. It's concerning, and we worry about it. And then I kind of added this one. Someone said doubt. Because we do have a lot of doubts in this life and questions. I use the word noetic. That's knowledge. Struggles, vexing questions, crises of faith. These we accompany us all the days of our lives until death. But we have now an assurance, a promise that we carry along with that. And of course, we mentioned taxes And this last one, whoops, I went too far. Someone came up and mentioned after class, you know, a good introvert who, you know, thinks for a while before they speak. Unlike me, I'd boo. Anyway, so, but she had a great point that when death happens now in Christ, we will be face to face with Jesus. That's what Paul says in first that love chapter. Right now we see through a mirror dimly, but then face to face. You know, and this is something else Mark Allen Powell, who, you know, put that little chart there that I got from his book, Loving Jesus. He makes a point in that book that we always are talking about the presence of Christ, right? I mean, Jesus is with us, God Emmanuel, God with us. But he said, you know, we also need to talk about Jesus' absence, because he was with the disciples and he went away and he will come again. And so, yes, we have him present through word and sacrament, and yet there is a longing that we have in this life to see him face to face, to no longer be separated by time or space. And so that ends with death. And I thought that was cool. I wanted to get that in there. All right, so last thing is Paul will say that we were enslaved to sin, and now we're slaves of righteousness. We have a new master. You gotta serve somebody. A lot of people think, oh, I get to make my own decisions. I'm free, I'm this. And actually, if you were honest, you're not. You're a slave to something. Maybe some people could make a point against that. But all right, so when it comes to this issue of good works, because remember, that's what we're talking about now. Where do those enter in and where do they come from? And Paul would say they come from baptism. You died with Christ. The new's just going to rise up in you. Listen to what Luther says in his treatise on good works. Because, again, he was criticized for being against good works. Let's read this little excerpt. We find that many people pray, fast, create pious endowments, do this and that, and lead respectable lives in the opinion of others. But if you ask them whether or not they are certain that God is pleased with them, there's that insurance, that is pleased with what they do, there's that assurance issue I was talking about, they do not know, or at least have their doubts. Moreover, they cite learned scholars who do nothing but teach good works and claim it is unnecessary to have such certainty. See here, Luther says, all these good works are performed apart from faith. They amount to nothing and are completely dead because the attitude of your conscience before God determines the goodness of the works that proceed from it. Now, I know this tweaks our sensibilities here, but hang in there with it. If there is no faith or good conscience toward God, your works are decapitated, and your life and goodness amount to nothing at all. Now you see why whenever I exalt faith and reject as false those works done without it, they accuse me of forbidding good works, although my real desire is to teach the genuine good works that belong to faith. Where do your good works come from? Keeping the law, creating your righteousness, or do they come from faith? Now, we had this discussion in my Thursday Bible study many months back, and people were really wrestling with it. You mean, like, unless my going down to the soup kitchen is completely, perfectly motivated, coming from faith without any benefit to myself, it's a horrible work? Well, no, it's not a horrible work from the standpoint of human beings goes. And all of our works, because remember, we've got that old nature and new nature, are going to be influenced by our old nature to some degree. It's not one way or the other. But when it comes to our status before God, what really is good, a good work comes out of faith and not the law. Okay, so Luther puts that up there for us. And so we're just going to keep going now with Romans 6:11, because it's the absolute total same subject, okay? Any questions? Comments? Move my chair. I'm going to move around here. Okay. All right. So let's go to, right? I think we read part of this, but let's just pick up here at verse 12. So Paul says, therefore, do not let sin exercise, that's an imperative, dominion. This is the word lord. No, I'm sorry. This is the word kingdom. So do not let sin exercise dominion in your mortal bodies to make you obey their passions. No longer present your members to sin as instruments of wickedness, which is adikaios, or opposite of righteousness. That's the literal word here. But present yourselves to God as those who have been brought from death to life. You've been baptized, you've died, now you've... So what do? We present ourselves to God in this way. And present your members to God as instruments of righteousness. For sin will have no dominion. I think this is the word for Lord. Kyrios, Lord, Kyrie, eleison, Lord have mercy. For sin will not be Lord over us. Since you are not under law, but under grace. For sin will have no dominion over you. Sin will not be your Lord, since you are not under law, but under grace. So, does Paul say that now that we're Christian, we're never going to sin? No, he doesn't say that. But now he says that sin, that turned inward nature, is not our Lord. It doesn't rule us. So don't present your body, don't present your life to sin. No, present your body to God to be an instrument of righteousness. So it just doesn't make sense for us to be thinking, oh goody, God forgives sins, I like to commit them, great arrangement. It just doesn't make sense, because that's the old Adam, it's the old Eve speaking. The new Christ in us, that's not the question. The new part of us wants to love and serve and care for our neighbor and worship and, you know, all the things we talk about in Christian practice and praxis. But this is a statement here. For sin will have no lordship, dominion over you, since you are not under law, but under grace. This is what I want us to talk about today. What does that look like? What does it look like? What does it feel like? What are some concrete examples of being under grace and not law? How does that make a difference for you and for us in our lives? That each day we wake up and we are under, you know, grace is our Lord, if you will, not the law. What does that do for us? How does that make a difference each and every day? This is what I want to think about. I want you to think about. The word dominion here, and up here, is the word for basileus, or kingdom, reign and rule. So don't let sin rule in your mortal bodies so that you obey their passions. So, you know, before Christ, that's the way it was. Even if we dressed it up and looked like really good moral people. Present yourselves to God. Because you now have a new master. And you are now under grace and not law. So, I don't know. Anybody got something here on this? That comes to mind? What does the day look like? How is it different if you're not under the law, but under grace? Jill, right there, Sue, right, perfect.
Oh, I got a big mouth.
Yeah, she'll just hold it for you. Yeah, it's fine.
It seems like if we're under grace, then every day is like a new day. It gives us a reason to try and to keep going, to do right.
Yes, right, beautiful, yeah.
It reminds me of in high school when I had a teacher that I really admired and liked, I wanted to do better.
Ah.
And I knew that if I made a mistake, there was less pressure.
Okay, interesting. So less pressure. Both those comments are really beautiful, fabulous. Others want to chime on? Bill over here. Yeah. Love it. What does it look like? Let's put some more together here.
One of the thoughts that came to me that happens to people at this point is they become less self-centered.
Sure, okay,
and,
less
and
self-centered.
Their whole approach, they're not thinking about themselves and making their decisions and their approach and so forth. They're more aware of the folks around them and their needs and things that they can do that will be helpful to them.
Okay, so less self-centered. Wait a minute. And this is kind of what you all are saying. You mean if I'm not under the law but under grace, I'm going to become less self-centered? I mean, without all those laws to make sure I'm doing everything right and dotting every I and crossing every T, how could it be that you would be less self-centered? Well, if you're concerned about dotting the I's and crossing the T's, who are you thinking about? When you're under grace and you know you can mess up and make a mistake, not like you try, but you don't get devastated by that. You get up and you go for it and you love and you serve, and now you can think not of yourself, but you can be focused out. Is that where you're going, Bill? Yeah, yeah, beautiful, beautiful. I think you're right on. This is beautiful. Up more? Yep, Dennis, please. And just hold it as close as you can. It's not too loud today for some.
I think related to that, you can forgive others now instead of judging them all the time for them not reaching what you think they should reach.
Ooh, wow. Look at what happens if you're under law. And remember, law always has its office. What does it do? It first and foremost drives us to the cross. But if it's no longer your Lord, then Dennis is saying you're more likely to be graceful and forgiving of others if you're under grace. I think you are onto something here. Putting aside for a minute whether something, I know there are ethical issues today that we debate about, whether something's right or wrong. But putting that debate aside just for a minute and then saying, if we're under grace, then when someone doesn't keep the law, whether we could debate about whether they are or they aren't, but doesn't, then we have not an ability to say you're condemned because of that, because we're under grace. And doesn't Jesus say this? With the judgment you judge, you will be judged. If you want to live by the law, be careful what you're asking for. So I think that's so true. I guess the other thing that you just get my head spinning on that, Dennis, is if we live under grace, I think since we've received grace, and this is just what you're saying, I'm just kind of reiterating, I guess, really. Since we've received grace, we're going to be more graceful with others. Think of the parable that Jesus tells. I'm going to mix up the details a little bit, but he's working with Peter, and he says, who appreciates forgiveness more? The one who's been forgiven a ton, or the one that's been forgiven for just a very little? And of course the disciples say, well, the one who's been forgiven a ton. Well, if we get that we've been forgiven that much, then, we look around at others and we're going to go, well, I'm not going to condemn you. I mean, whether or not we say what they're doing or not doing is wrong or right, I'm not going to condemn you for that. They're a child of God. They're loved by Almighty God. And so, yes, I think we can be more graceful with others now that we're under grace. The other thing is, I think let's talk about expectations when it comes to our relationships to others. That's the other thing that you get me thinking. I think we should have high expectations of those in our lives, but we have to hold them very loosely. The key, this is Bill Crabtree now, this is not the Apostle Paul or whatever, okay? One of the keys for me in being in the church, because, you know, just going through my journey, is I realized that really high expectations of my brothers and sisters in Christ is going to get me in trouble. Now, if you're just living under the law, then what are you talking about? Of course you have the highest expectation. They should always be doing all these good things and never let you down. But I'm not saying I don't have expectations of you, and you shouldn't have expectations of me, but I'm going to hold them lightly. I'm going to be ready for them not to be met. And I can tell you, the most angry and bitter people in the world who have super high expectations and no one ever meets their expectations and they're angry all the time. I mean, I didn't plan to go there, but I know we're all upset about the government in one way or the other, but I don't have that high expectation. Now, I'm not saying I don't have some expectation, but I believe in the depravity of humanity and the brokenness of humanity, so I expect it is not going to go smoothly. And whatever side of the aisles or aisle you're on, you know, I'm not saying don't care, but I'm saying what you expect is going to dictate how upset you are from day to day. That is what makes us frustrated. So, and again, I'm not saying have no expectations. Don't hear me wrong. I'm saying if you live under grace, have expectations, but hold them lightly. I had some really beloved friends let me down in college who were like my fellow brothers, you know, in Christ, and it devastated me. But God brought me up and said, Bill, how many people have you let down? You know, mate, how do you know that you haven't, you know, because you didn't say hi to somebody or do something or show up or, you know, so we're all going to have that. We're all going to get let down. Get ready for it. We're sinners. This is a hospital for sinners, right? We've talked about this. So so expect, but then live on, you're under grace. So now your expectations are more graceful, I guess. How about that in marriage? How about that in parenting? How about that in, you know, taking care of our parents or whatever it is? I think it's powerful. Okay, you got me on a sermon, Dennis. Thank you. Okay, and all of you guys just hit it out of the park just now. Others, you want to jump off some more on this? Yeah. Okay. Yeah, please. We got... she's equidistant to both of you. Tom's coming up. There we go. Thanks, Kelly. Perfect.
This reminds me of the exercise we did in a previous congregation I belonged to. The pastor was trying to convince the congregation that they were sinners all day long, every day. Mm-hmm. Because people have a hard concept with this, right? They think they're good people. And so you don't think about being a sinner all the time. So all the members of the congregation selected a day, any day they could pick whatever day they wanted. And they had a piece of paper and pencil with them all day long. And every time that they sinned, not that you were going to share your list,
right.
But every time you sinned, you got a chance to write it down on this piece of paper. And then we all brought our pieces of paper in, and we folded them in little tight wads so nobody would ever see them.
Yeah.
And we nailed them to the cross. Mm-hmm. And it was a powerful experience to realize that all day long, your thoughts, what you do, what you don't do, I mean, hundreds of times a day,
Yeah. You
are sinning.
Yeah.
I mean, I could describe all the sins that I had between here and home when I was driving to church today, right?
Yeah.
We don't really want
to
have my list.
Yes.
But I could, right?
Sure.
Because now that I realize that all the sinning you do all day long, so it's not like you sin from time to time.
Yeah. Yeah.
And you are living under grace, and God forgives you for that one time. You are living under sin all day long.
Yes.
And so when you have grace and faith that you have been redeemed, you can live with yourself.
Yes, yes. You absolutely. You don't have to get devastated by that list. What do you do with it? You take it to the cross. You could, and that's a beautiful, tangible way to see that. Beautiful. Jim?
I'm trying to relate this now to my own, let's say, personal situation now with Parkinson's. And I don't want to imply that I don't go see the doctors, don't try to follow, get better.
Right.
But I also realize that this is permanent.
Mm-hmm.
And now it becomes a question of acceptance.
Yeah.
And how can I accept it without the grace of God?
Yeah.
And that's what it brought me home with it. I live with it every morning.
Sure.
I'm feeling okay.
Yeah.
But some days I realize it's okay. I'm okay.
Yeah.
I don't have to feel like I'm okay,
right,
or think I'm okay. I just am okay.
There you go. And beautiful.
That's not because of anything I've done.
Right. That's a gift. Beautiful. Love it. Hey, isn't this amazing to live under grace? When I think of the benefits of the gospel, that's, I mean, this gets right to the core. Let's see, I want to go here to this. In 1518, I hope you guys aren't tired of Luther. Anyway, if you are, I'm sorry. I mean, there are a lot of other people since Luther, and I brought C.S. Lewis in once. Anyway, in 1518, so 95 Theses, 1517, 1518, so this is really early on, in Luther's kind of awakening and the I guess you could say, the fire of the Reformation. But he's now getting pretty famous, and he this is a theological debate he's having with some other folks, I believe in the Augustinian order, that they're having this discussion. And so after he's written his 95 Theses, which were against indulgences, now he's putting some more of his thoughts, and these go out for debate. And he has a philosophical one and a theological one. This is from the theological. And you can see that he's got it now. And you got to know that he's read Romans 6, that we, and the verse we just have been studying. Look what he says. He is not righteous, or the one is not righteous who does much, but the one who, without work, believes much in Christ. The law says, and this is my favorite sentence, the law says, do this, and it's never done. Isn't that true? I mean, it's like my garage. Man, it just talks to me when I come home. It says, get this cleaned up, and I do it, but then there's something else. It's never done. Unless you, if you have one of those garages that's immaculate, I don't want to talk to you. Don't be talking to me. Anyway, I envy you. But from the law standpoint, it's never done. The law is always that. Do this, do that, be better, you know, et cetera. And it's never done. But grace says, believe this, and everything is already done. You know, back to whatever somebody from last week, you know, reminded me to quote Gerhard Ferdi, a famous Lutheran theologian, who said, what are you going to do now that you don't have to do anything? Well, now we get to do things. So in his defense of this thesis, a little later, he says, the second part is clear from the same sources, for faith justifies, and the law, says St. Augustine. So Augustine was 300s, 4th century church father, incredibly influential in the West. So the law commands what faith obtains. So the law is always there commanding. It still has its office, its place. We don't get rid of it. It's there. Luther's small catechism starts out with what? The Ten Commandments. So you can see, if he, and his large canon, so if, you know, the law is still there, but the law, what the law commands, faith obtains as a gift, and we've studied that. For through faith, Christ is in us. And this is what I want you to get, because you might be asking, well, how is this work? Christ is in us, indeed one with us. What did he say? We've been joined with Christ in baptism. So your journey is joined up, linked up with Christ. So indeed, we are one with Christ. Christ is just and has fulfilled all the commands of God. Wherefore, we also fulfill everything through him. Since he was made ours through faith. There you go. Through faith, the promise of God, our trusting in that. We have Christ, and now we have his righteousness. So grace says, believe this, and everything is already done. That's the assurance you can take with you every day. So you get out there and do your best, and you, when you mess up, you don't have to kill yourself about it. When sin gets the best of you, and usually just when we think we are in great shape, then whoop. So you go back to the cross, and you go back on your knees, confess your sins, receive the absolution, and on you go. Let me go back here now to... So just a quick review of this. So dominion, Basileus, reign, who rules you is the question. Are old rulers the law? And I don't care what anybody says, whether they're religious or not, the law rules their life, standards, expectations. You know, it's just they maybe have a different law or a different standard, you know. But now we're under the rule or dominion of grace. So notice that law is contrasted with grace, and that's where I put those in there. So let's get these down. You always know when law's working by some particular words. Shoulda, woulda, coulda. When you get shoulda'd, you know that's the law. So we're not under the dominion, though, of the law, the shouldas, the musts, and the have-tos, but now we're under the rule of get-tos and mays. Now when it comes to what we do, that I may love God, that I may serve my neighbor, now it's a true sense of freedom. So we already did that. I jumped the gun a little bit. So we did that. Perfect. Let's go back to Romans. Any more comments right there with where we're at? We didn't get very far yet, so we're going to keep going. Please. Yeah, Lisa and then Jim over here. Yeah.
I just have a question. Aren't we under both law and grace?
Aren't we under both law and grace? The answer is complicated, but to give a simple answer, if I had to say yes or no, we're not under the law. When it comes to righteousness, assurance, that I'm a child of God, that I'm accepted by God, we are not under the law. That is not how we have the promise of God's assurance. We are under grace and faith. But the law still has its office. So in that sense, the law doesn't rule us, but the law still has its function and purpose in our lives. It shows us what it is to have a God and what it is to love our neighbor. We're human beings. And in particular, this is where it gets complicated. If we've got an old Adam and a new and the Christ in us, if we've got an old Eve and the Christ in us, then the Christ in us doesn't need the law. Again, go back to the sheep and the goats parable. When did we see you? Well, inasmuch as you've done the least of these. They didn't know they were doing it. The Christ in us loves, serves, cares. I don't help someone as I go about my day because, oh, you know, the law says I should love my neighbor. See the should? So I just do it. So the Christ in me is not, now when it comes to being righteous before God, accepted, I am no longer under the law. The law is done. But because I'm a human being, I still need the law. It shows me, helps me see where the right and wrong is, and most of all, when it comes to the law and its function, without it, I don't know I need grace. So I think your question is awesome, because I don't want to say that the law now can just be completely discarded. And people have made this mistake. They made that mistake with Luther. That's not what he's saying. But he's saying that when it comes to our acceptance and being righteous before Almighty God, that we are not under the law. That is not the way it happens. Helpful?
Yes.
Okay, good. Jim and then Bill.
So when I'm thinking about this creation, God's creation.
Yeah.
And where faith, law, and righteousness all are out. Are we talking now of God's having faith in his creation? In other words, Christ was given to us for the love of God, out of love.
Yes.
Where would it stand that God has faith in his creation? In other words, why do all of this for nothing?
Yeah. That's a great question. I think I'm going to have to ponder that. Does God have faith in his creation and in us? Why do it? I guess the only answer that comes to my mind is to jump further down in Romans, where Paul says something pretty, we're going to have to really work to get our heads around. He says, God consigned the world to disobedience. He gave it over to disobedience that he might have mercy on all. So, does God have faith in us?
We're going to make it.
I think what God is concerned about is, God has faith in us. I think God is faithful, and God wants us to have a promise and be merciful to us. But I'm going to have to think about that.
Yeah.
That's great. Bill, yeah.
The phrase you had up there earlier that I think is very helpful concerning the law is get to.
Yes. Yes, get to. Now we get to.
Get to.
It's not a have to, it's a get to. Yeah, that's really key. Yep, good. Okay, let's keep going. Maybe we'll get to the end in the 10 minutes of chapter 6. What then? Because now we got another what then. So now that he's said all this, should we sin because we are not under law but under grace? Hopefully that question makes sense to you. That's what we've been talking about. By no means. Do you not know that if you present yourselves to anyone as obedient slaves, you are slaves of the one whom you obey, either of sin, which leads to death, or of obedience, which leads to righteousness? But thanks be to God that you, having once been slaves of sin, have become obedient. Now, this is what's really cool about this verb tense. This is that indicative I talked about in the sermon last week. These are things that we don't do, that are done to us and for us. We are actually even, these green lines is a passive verb, so that this is action that's been done to us. We were slaves of sin, but now we've become obedient from the heart, see that? Not from the law, but from the heart, to the form of the teaching to which you were entrusted. So we're going to conform ourselves to Christ, and that you, having been set free from sin, have become slaves of righteousness. So now we have a new master. And in Christ, that's what's happened. Without speaking in human terms because of your natural limitations. I love that. I'm trying to make this make sense to you, you know. For just as you once presented your members to slaves to impurity and greater iniquity, so now present. What are we supposed to do? This is an imperative here. Present your members as slaves to righteousness for sanctification. Present your members as slaves of righteousness for sanctification. So now what I do is I put myself before the Word. If I want to get better, going to present my body and let God work on me through the word, through the sacraments, through confession and forgiveness, through being a part of the body of Christ. Again, I know I've said this a billion times lately, but I think it works. Mark Allen Powell said, make yourself a big target for the Holy Spirit. Why not? Why make it hard? You know? So now that's what I do. I present myself to God and let God, the Holy Spirit, make me a new person and keep me going. And I've found I do better that way than trying to do it myself somehow. Anyway, Doug?
Yeah, would this be a good time to jump ahead to Romans chapter 12, verses 1 and 2?
Renewal of your mind?
Yes.
It's certainly, present your, certainly is. Present yourselves, your body, as a living sacrifice by the renewal of your mind. So we can just go there real quick. Let's shoot over here and put Romans 12. So when it comes to this new life in Christ, I appeal to you, therefore, brothers and sisters, by the mercy of God, present your bodies as a living sacrifice, holy and acceptable to God, which is your spiritual worship. Let's see.
Yeah, verse 2.
Verse 2. Do not be conformed to this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your minds, so that you may discern what is the will of God, what is good and acceptable and perfect. I can totally see why you thought of this, Doug. Now, the key thing is what is, how do you renew your mind? And the word for mind here in Greek is that nous, or noetic. And when you look at the way Paul talks about it, when he uses the word mind, we now have, Paul says in another spot, the mind of Christ in us. So when he's talking about the renewal of your mind, he's talking about the renewal of Christ, Christ's mind in you. Again, going back to just what I said, you know, put yourselves before God. Present yourselves as a living sacrifice. Perfect, Doug, point to bring that in. And that will then, we do that for sanctification. We are made holy in this presenting ourselves to God and letting God work on us. Let's finish up here, and then we will be at verse chapter 7. When you were slaves of sin, you were free in regard to righteousness. In other words, you could decide, well, maybe I'll do the good thing or not. But, maybe I'll do the good thing. Yeah. Like, but I've got to do the bad thing, which is interesting. So what advantage did you get from the things of which you are now ashamed? The end of those things is death. But now that you have been freed from sin and enslaved to God, the advantage you get is sanctification. The end is eternal life. So that's what you get. Paul uses the word Ionios Zoe here, a little bit different than Jesus says in the Gospel of John, but the end, now you have life eternal. So you're sanctified now, and in the future you have this eternal life. For the wages of sin is death, but the free gift of God is eternal life in Christ Jesus our Lord. This is one of those great memorizable scriptures. The wages of sin is death. That's what ends up happening. Isn't that the end of our human sin? It brings about loss, death, destruction. One way or another, destruction of relationships, destruction. I mean, that's where it ends up. But the free gift of God, and note we get grace back in here, free gift, not half-earned, half gift. It's the free gift of God is eternal life in Jesus Christ our Lord. So, so you can see now Paul, after saying what he said about righteousness, has to kind of say, now what about all these works? And what about, you know, where good stuff comes out of us? And I go back to that. We're not under the law anymore when it comes to that. We are under grace. Thoughts, questions, like what about this? What about that? We're right at about the end of our time. Okay. Now, if you're saying you should have up here, just let's finish this way then, since I don't see any questions. If you're saying to yourself, well, then how come, Pastor Bill, if we are not slaves to sin anymore, every Sunday in the old green hymnal, and we still do this in the cranberry hymnal, although we use a little bit different word, we used to say we are in bondage to sin and cannot free ourselves. Wouldn't it have been better? Shouldn't it say we used to be in bondage to sin? Because Paul says that we're no longer slaves of sin, but this Lutheran hymnal has us get up and say we're in bondage to sin. Every Sunday in the cranberry it says we're captive to sin. So, what's going on here? Are we messing up with the Apostle Paul? Are we not getting this right? Why would we continue to say we're in bondage to sin? I had a member in my last congregation, wonderful, devoted, faithful guy, but he loved the Pentecostal tradition, which isn't necessarily bad. But in that tradition, and in the teachers and preachers he used to love to listen to, they would say, you do not call yourself a sinner. You're a Christian now, and you are not a sinner. You are what you say you are. Because they have this big thing about, you know, you bring about whatever you say. He would not say that on Sunday mornings. And he often took me to task on this. And he said, you know, wait, why are we speaking something into truth? We're just making us more sinners. If you call yourself a sinner, you're going to be more of a sinner. So stop calling yourself a sinner. And I would say, well, and I don't want to use this first name because I don't want to. But did you sin this week? And if he said no, I'd say, well, you gave Jesus the day off, did you? But of course he would not say he didn't sin. But he would say, no, but I don't talk about myself as a sinner. I'm not in bondage to sin anymore. And I said, yes, you are. Because you got to read Romans 7. Which is where we're going. We are set free. We are no longer bondage to sin, but Paul's going to turn around in chapter 7, and we're going to get, oh my goodness, he's going to wrestle with the law, and we get down here, this inner conflict. Sold into slavery, understand, I do not understand my own actions. I do not do what I want. I do the very thing I hate. Now, if I do what I do not want, I agree that the law is good. And he goes on and he says, I find that there's another law at work within me. So, we got the reality of chapter 6, which is true, but we got chapter 7 coming along that's going to say we have another law at work within us. And so, this is where we get into this lovely appreciation in the Lutheran Christian tradition of paradox. How can two things be true that conflict with each other? And we love paradox here, if you didn't know that. All right, that'll do it for today. God bless you. We have one more class next week, and then we'll take some break for Christmas. God's
tables and chairs, you can leave all the chairs out.